All right. Say hi to the camera. Hey, what's up? Huh, this is fun. All right, so.
Did you see that?
Here's a big welcome back to this week's episode and the premiere of my short film, Doppel. I want to start with a disclaimer. I shot this back in 2014, and I got a lot of editing done with it before I eventually shelved it. I was going through some old hard drives recently and rediscovered the project and realized it wasn't half bad. So I finished it. That really embodies the heart of this channel for me. As a personal project, I wanted to create more and to give myself the space to make films out of the countless hours of footage that I've shot on trips and around the house. On today's episode, I want to take you behind the scenes inside the project for Doppel and talk about what went into filming and editing this project. In the future, I want to do more of this with some of the larger projects that I've helped to produce, edit, and DP. Last thing, if you've enjoyed what we've been doing on this channel, consider giving the video a like now before you get to the end of it and forget to give it a like. All right, I'm going to let life take over from here. Life.
When did you get here?
Let's go. So what I came to appreciate about going back through this project after not having touched it for 5 or 6 years now was actually seeing what I've learned since then and what I could add to it that I know I wasn't thinking about at the time. So when I first began this project, you'll see right off the bat that it has to do with this effect, okay? This doppelganger effect, basically. So if we go to a part here where I actually pass in front of the camera, this was the effect I was going for. I wanted to utilize something that I had explored before, where I could actually film myself and film a duplicate of myself passing in front, interacting with, just to see if I could do it. I based everything off of these moments, these small moments that I could find, and I really liked this idea of some kind of mysterious sci-fi genre something. So let's actually get into some of the work here. The first one that you'll see, the first effect, is actually this effect where I appear from behind the car. None of this rotoscoping work, by the way, is tediously done or very professional. You'll see as we go frame by frame that it's actually kind of sloppy work. Even inside the After Effects project, you'll notice I've got a mask around the car here, and there's actually like a little bit of a warping around the trees and everything that happens. But honestly, everything happens so fast that unless you really know what you're looking for or you're looking for these imperfections, then you're just not gonna pick up on it. So that was the first piece that we took on here. Was actually me getting into the scene, and I wanted it to be this mysterious, wide, long opening where, you know, this character appears out of nowhere and just starts to explore, and you don't really know what or why. Later on, I actually added the title here, and I just felt like it was a good place for the title to come in. I was kind of going for, obviously, a little bit of that, like, Stranger Things, mysterious sci-fi vibe. And the double P came in back to back like that. Later on, I had done a pass of this originally, which you probably saw, where that wasn't like that. I changed things up just a little bit. So yeah, there's a little bit of a glowing effect in here, some grain, there's some bark texture. So that's what all of this is. I had this, you know, orangey yellow pass over top of it. It's a few different, it's a few different effects layered on top of each other, and there's a bunch of pre-comps here for no reason. But you'll see I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 layers of the same text there. So the original is just this color. And then I added this bark texture to it, which is a pre-comp all on its own with just this like rotating multi-layered bark texture. It scales, it rotates. It just has some complex movement to it. I wanted it to be a little weird and, you know, move in this really subtle way. So let me get back into this here. Okay, so that's the first part of it. So then there's another pre-comp of the bark over top of it, which I just have different transfer layers to get some of these effects that I wanted, followed by a series of these texts added on. So the next one I did is actually this text layer on top of the bark layer, which is another alpha map for it. So I actually don't know if that stays on or off, but we'll find out. Followed by a series of layers here. These are all designed with some blur. One of them has a little bit of a turbulent displacement in order to give it that kind of like glowing, like blending haze kind of effect for it. And then just a light glow on top of that, which just gives it a little bit of edge, followed by finally just another layer at 50% in order to get some of that color into it. So we dropped it in right on top of this wide opening shot here to give a little bit more mystery and add a little bit of that like creepy texture to this opening shot. This next one, I honestly didn't spend a whole lot of time on this graphic itself. I wanted to repeat these kind of orangey looks throughout everything. So I have a little bit of an orange glow over top of the phone and this grid, which, you know, honestly, it looks like this just because I couldn't like rotate it. It was just kind of lazily done. Honestly, the idea was just to get the project finished. I wanted to not stall it any longer. I didn't want to have to spend days trying to come up with something and you know, redo this whole piece here. And I don't do, you know, displays and that kind of stuff usually. So something maybe I could do in the future with it, but for now I just wanted it finished. So you know, you get the idea. There's some sci-fi sound effects which we'll get to later on, and this you know, just a little masked layer here. You'll see. Here's the grid on it, and there's actually a mask on top of one of these layers. Here's the mask here. So you can see my mask. I just did it frame by frame and just followed it. I tried automating that and I couldn't do it. So, you know, I just followed it, tracked it all the way up, and, you know, that's how that effect is accomplished. Underneath it with the bark layer, this is literally just a still layer. So that bark layer underneath, I just took one shot where I see all of that bark texture, and I just did a freeze frame on it. That's where I added the grid to as well, so that all of that masked effect just comes in right underneath it. And then I followed that up as a transfer layer over top of the original so that I could blend it. Moving on, you know, here's just a series of things where I'm, you know, clearly looking for something. It's a part of building that story. You know, it's leading me closer and closer to the house. So we started far away, have this establishing shot that we get that we are inside of somebody's residence in the woods somewhere. We don't really know what or why. I'm scanning bark. Again, that's where that bark theme is coming in. You know, I wanted to play into the idea that maybe this could have to do with some kind of sci-fi world where, you know, some people are sent into the past and, you know, have to figure out what's going on with the plant life and, you know, why things turned out the way they did, or looking for something in particular that they need to bring back to the future in order to save things. You know, just real typical stuff, but leaving it open-ended enough that I could actually explore more story to it if I really wanted to. So we're moving closer to the house, and as we get to it, I start to create some of these, rotations and scales. So that's something that like is a little bit of like a noir, a film noir effect, to have the Dutch angle incorporated, but also this like slow movement, again, adding to the idea that something's off, something's not right, and giving it that creepy vibe that I was really hoping to capture. Followed by the first instance of the doppelganger effect that was the purpose for this. Again, it's another tilted image here. This one actually was shot that way. So I chose to off my frame just by a little bit in order to give it that Dutch and, you know, cheap tripod. I did the best I could with it, but I think it sells that idea just a little bit. Something is not quite right. Obviously, I was captivated by something in the direction of what looks to be the house. And now you can see a fence here. You can see a car parked in front of it. That tree is still there. Just kind of trying to make sure that everybody knows where the space is and where the movement is going. Followed then by the first pass in front of. So this is when you know, the character of me first realizes that somebody's here. And obviously he's not supposed to be here, or he's not supposed to meet somebody, or again, leaving an open-ended story to suggest, all right, there's some reason that he needs to be hiding. You know, he's not being chased by for any reason. So somebody isn't supposed to know that he is here. And you know, this is another case of just a honestly sloppy rotoscope job. If I go frame by frame, you will see just how bad it gets. Here's the layer with me there and the layer underneath. So here's the whole mask. You can see it doesn't even like try to get close to me. You know, I try to leave out a few spots here where I know I come in, but that's kind of it. So once you put the layer back on top of it, if we zoom in a little bit, you'll notice like things disappear. I'm kind of blurred out a little bit. Again, though, this isn't Hollywood and nobody's gonna scrutinize it that deeply. I don't think you would hardly even notice it unless you knew what to look for in that moment. If you do, then, you know, whatever. Maybe you do now and you think it's obvious. The next little thing I wanted to do, this happened actually after the fact. It wasn't originally in my edit. So to have this like impacted moment, I wanted to jolt the screen in the same way that the audience should maybe jolt. When you hear that scuffle of the shoes and there's a little bit of like a thud sound in the background, you know, I wanted to have this big change from one screen to the next. So there's actually a scale effect that takes place right there. Right at that moment of jumping. The soundtrack rises at the same time and changes slightly. There is a little bit of a riser and a thud, or, you know, hit impact effect, and the whole turn and shuffle at the same time, I think just leads to this moment where you can, you know, where you can force the shock into the scene. This was another one of those effects I wanted to try. So I was getting a little bit overconfident maybe in this one, but the idea here was to do a rack focus on myself without actually racking focus. So I had to do all of that digitally. So I didn't have a rack focus on the original layer here, where it's just me going into the house, which meant that I had to blend in that rack focus one with the original. Now the frame doesn't move, thankfully, so that keeps everything centered and helps it to blend just fine. But that's just one way to kind of overcome the limitations sometimes. This literally had no budget. You know, it was me on an afternoon, just bored and trying to do something that I thought was maybe interesting and, you know, just playing around with some ideas. So moving on from there, another series of brief ones. I really like this shot, actually, this sequence here. I thought they were really fun. Angles and a really neat way to continue to explore the character doing something that is kind of mysterious. You're not really sure what is it. You know, ominous, is it maniacal? We don't really know. We don't even really know anything about this character. For all we know, he's just trespassing. So, you know, we're setting him up as the hero, not really knowing what's taking place coming up here. This next one was another instance where I did a Dutch you know, rotation basically, and a scale effect, but I didn't have that initially in there. It just felt like a moment when I started adding in the soundtrack and the sound effects and all of that, where I thought, okay, this is a good opportunity to really make it feel like this, you know, person's world is kind of spinning, or something feels wrong and feels, you know, almost inverted, like it shouldn't be, you know, happening. Which brings us to the reveal of who this character is that I've been following. As the other me enters the room, you'll notice there's a little bit of a glitch. Just a couple frames of a glitch there, and it actually does like a reverse. So these are all intentional moves to show that something is duplicated and wrong with these two people encountering each other here. So they both should not be in the same setting. Again, I'm really trying to set myself up for something that could be done in the future. And another instance I'll show you here in After Effects of just a really sloppy roto job. I actually had to go in and clean this one up when I started on this project again, because it was just so bad. It really is still not great. Like, you can see my hand there passing in front of the window. I should have like done something with that. You know, like feather it more or something. I don't know. I don't know if I'd even do anything for it. You know, other complications are I get so close to the window that shadows pass in front of it. You know, I try to keep things as consistent as possible between the two, meaning like the curtains weren't dropped in one and then in the other. You know, there was nothing blocking it. The lighting didn't really change. I went and I shot really quickly this one, changed, and then came in the room and shot the next part, all while Audra was basically rolling her eyes at me. She thought I was just totally crazy doing this. Kind of a sloppy work, but again, it's passable and you get the idea of something off happening here. That's probably another really important part to stress, is don't stop the project because you can't accomplish something perfectly. Get through, get to the end, and finish something, and afterwards learn from whatever little, you know, problems happened and change that the next time you go to do it. Don't be afraid to take on things that seem just outside of what you're capable of doing. Every time I take on a short film project, I try to add some level of complexity more than what I did in the past. Something that will add a new little effect, or something that'll force me to have to light something in a very specific way or in a complex way, or have a few more people, or just something that I've been researching that I've been wanting to test out, that I'm wanting to do some work on, and give me an opportunity to help grow what I know and grow the skills that I have. Because here's the deal, you're gonna, you know, fail a couple of times trying to figure out how to accomplish something, maybe even more than that. You're going to find out what mistakes were made and maybe even how it can be done differently so that you don't make those in the future. That's where the troubleshooting comes in. And it takes a lot of that. Whenever you find something's wrong, go look it up, go search for it, go try to figure out what happened. What do these communities say about it? Is it something other people are encountering? If it's not, what am I doing? What are my settings? All of this that tries to help you uncover more and more and more how, you know, the filmmaking process works, especially for those of us that are self-taught. It's really important to try to learn every phase we possibly can and pick up the best education possible through the research that we do after the fact, because, you know, there's no teacher there to instruct us along the way, showing us, you know, before we make the mistakes, that something's not going to be how we want it. So that's the final bit of effect there, followed by, you know, this grand last one, which I'm sure you can figure out pretty easily. It's just, you know, clean plate and then me, and the inevitable disappearance. Here I am, you know, clearly looking at something. This is, you hear the sound effects underneath, doing some typing and some, you know, processing, so that when I look up, then it makes sense. You know, obviously I'm bewildered. Here it is. This is me. But I'm not so bewildered. This has been an important one for me too. Capturing the look right. So in this moment, I didn't want it to look like, how is it possible that I'm here too? I was really trying to tell more of, why am I here? That lingering question of, okay, he's not shocked, but he is surprised to find him in a place that maybe he wasn't supposed to be. So there's a hint of, I'm familiar with this scenario. And that leaves a little bit of interest, because it's a really odd situation to be put in, where you see yourself. And then followed by all the other little things that we did along the way, with the scanning of the trees and with the appearance and disappearance, it leads to this question of what's going on and what happens after this. So the other thing I wanted to hit on before we end this is actually the importance of your sound effects and the sound tracking. When I was going through this, I didn't have a soundtrack. I didn't have any of these effects, just what I had caught there. And I didn't really plan on adding a whole lot. I knew I needed some like sci-fi beepings and ticking sounds in order to capture whatever it was that I was doing on the tree and kind of sell the effect. But as I was re-editing this just last week, I was going through some soundtracks and I noticed that these like creepy vibe with like really ambient sounds, you know, they've got little hums and maybe a little bit of like a wind sound built into them. Not really like a heavy soundtrack, but some low strings and synths and that sort of thing was really transforming the intention behind this project from the beginning, but in a way that I felt like worked really nicely for it. I loved what it did in the end, where it told this creepy, strange world where, you know, sci-fi possibilities exist. Now, I created a layer, I built them first out here, just as a base layer of those sounds that I wanted. And it just kind of moves and changes a little bit and fades out, fades back in, and then it has some kind of conclusion because I knew I needed it to say something to me. The phone is communicating with me. There's no, there's one line in it at all, and it's just me at the end, talking to somebody off camera. So I needed this phone to interact with me in some way. And this was what it was doing. It was telling me, okay, maybe not this tree. And you kind of get that idea. So confusion, got to move on to the next one. After I built that one, I realized I wanted some kind of texture to be a continuous, like looping sound, almost like a soundtrack throughout. And that's what you'll hear here. All this is. So this is just nothing but a series of looping noises. I created a nested layer and then I built all of these sounds into what I wanted. Kind of like a room tone noise, if you will, where it's just a continuous humming, you know, with a few little ticks and stuff here and there, and then I added a little bit more on top of that. Okay? So I have this moving throughout the whole piece that helps to build a little bit of that rhythm, because it's a consistent sound throughout. And it builds up and up and up until the moment when I pass in front of myself for the first time. One more instance of using that soundtrack. So when I stand up here, I needed something to tell me that things aren't right. And you know, sound's a good way to do that. You're familiar with certain alarms and triggers that let's say alert or emergency. So I created this little piece here, which is kind of an alarm going off. Followed by me looking at the phone, you can tell something's wrong. I begin investigating. And then the last little pieces here are the glitch.
Right.
As I pass in front, followed by another series of ticks and beeps and things that help to show what I'm doing off screen, which is interacting with that phone once again. And then that nice little like wind suck sound to symbolize the disappearance. So that is everything from this project so far. If there's anything else that I feel like I could make a little deeper tutorial out of later on, I'd love to do something like that. If you see something that you'd like to know more about, let me know in the comments. I'd be happy to explore a bit more of, you know, some of the effects or how to shoot for some of these effects in mind, because that's another key ingredient to this, is to know ahead of time what you're going to be doing inside of After Effects and what your final result is going to be, so that you can make plans based on that and you can shoot things accordingly to give you the easiest possible or the best possible outcome that you can get. Thanks.
I'm glad he handled that. I forgot like half of that stuff. Look, I know how difficult it can be to finish a project. I've got a handful more of these just waiting to be done. But I hope seeing some of this process gives you some inspiration to finish just one project. That's actually another reason that I wanted to start this channel. I'm a self-educated filmmaker, which means I mostly piece together what I know through YouTube and blogs. I spent years watching tutorials and skimming through Google for inspiration and answers to my challenges on editing, lighting, writing, and all the troubleshooting along the way. So I'm covering these topics and sharing what I've learned to give you a resource to finish your films. I want to make this a community where you can find the inspiration to finish. If you found any of this interesting, and if you didn't already like the video, go ahead and like it now. Was this helpful? Is there something that you feel motivated you to get the next steps done on your personal project? let me know in the comments. And if you're interested in following along with what we're doing in the future, go ahead and subscribe and hit that notifications bell. It's the best way to stay up to date. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time. Life. Life, say goodbye.
We ready to start?
What's up?
That doesn't make sense.